Today I'm joined by Katrine Fruelund. Katrine is two-time Olympic champion representing Denmark in handball. Katrine was selected the best handball player of the 2004 Olympic Games. Welcome, Katrine.
Thank you very much.
Katrine, when and where did the love for handball start?
Oh, it began, I think, when I was 8 years old. I always had a passion for sport, and we played a lot of football out in our garden, and my mother and father played football, and my younger brother also. I was a little shy to, you know, join a group. But one of my mother's friends, she took me under her wing, and then got me in the handball hall, and then I started. And luckily, there was a lot of my school friends also playing handball, so I think that was very important, just to stay there with them.
Yeah, cool. And in your life, you had a lot of bright moments, but what was the darkest moment?
I think that was right before the 2000 Olympics in Sydney. I was so tired of playing handball, so tired of always be the best, you know, always to give the best of me. I was very long down, and I think that was actually the year before. It was very hard, and I used a lot of time talking with psychologist, what you call them, mental trainers, and also some of my teammates. Camille Andersen, also a famous Denmark handball player, helped me a lot in the national team and talked a lot of talked a lot with me about it and how I could get through this period of my time. And I think that's always, I didn't join the, I think it was European Championship with the national team in 2000. I didn't join that because I was so full up by everything, I think, in my life and also handball. So it was a dark moment, but also I learned a lot also about how I reacted in this period and how to deal with it.
And when did the love for handball come back, and how did you recover from the moment? Because at the 2000 Olympics, you participated.
Yeah. I think it was a combination about not being afraid to admit that I was down and had problem to stay in, to get focused. And this is, yeah, this is this part of admitting that I had a problem. I think that was very important. And then I took all the help that I could get. And I think that helped me a lot to admit it and then talk to good people so they could help me and give me some tools to work with. And that was very important.
Yeah. I think it's a bit of a trait of high performance athletes that they are perfectionists. So admitting weaknesses or difficulties is probably a challenge. What advice would you give younger athletes, for example, who are in the same situation that they're struggling but don't really know how to deal with it or express it?
Yeah, I think the advice that, you know, you want to be 100% all the time, 110 if that was possible, but you cannot be every time. But if you then just say to yourself, okay, maybe it's 90% that will be okay for me in this period or this to the next match or something. So don't expect 100%, but then maybe only 90%. That's also enough. I think that helped me just not to want to do everything right, because you cannot do that.
Yeah. What was your best moment?
Oh, it's difficult because I think you have a period of a national team, and you also have some periods in the clubs you have joined over the years. But of course, I have this period of time when we won the Olympics in 2004, and we also won with my club in Viborg. We also won the national championship here in Denmark, and had a very good period. And I have a very confident time of me as an athlete. I think I have settled a little bit more down in my everything in my body, and I was calm, and I was also this, I trusted myself.
Yeah. And if you could travel back in time 10, 15 years, maybe 20 years, what advice would you give a younger Katrine?
Enjoy and not think so much about all the mistakes that I've done in every match. Because sometimes for me, the mistakes, that was the one thing I focused on instead of focusing on some of the good things. So I had a lot of time only focusing on the bad things that I have done. So not think so much about the bad things and the mistakes in a match.
So, but wouldn't be focusing on the bad things maybe also made you push a little bit harder and thrive for more?
Of course, when you make mistakes, you want to do better. And then that's also a good thing, because I also spend a lot of time alone in the field, in the playing hall with one trainer and only me and him, and make exercises and movements just to get something right, maybe 10 minutes, 15, 20 minutes, and then stop just to practice the same movement again and again and again. And that's also the good things about want to improve all the time. But and of course, that's how you get better. But sometimes it can be too much to think about all the mistakes all the time, and don't want to accept the good things sometimes, because I only want to make, I didn't do this movement right, and only focusing about that instead of something else that can be too much.
What are the habits that make you a successful athlete in person?
Maybe also this, I want to be better all the time. And using these periods of me alone in the training hall with no goalkeeper, only training with I hang shirts in the corners and everything, and just practice this, all the things. And of course, the dedication and to want to train, to want to have this the good feeling in your body that you can, when you are in good shape and everything. That's of course a good habit. And then I also think that we had a lot of fun also, and that's also very important. We have a lot of fun in the teams that I have played in. And that was important, because it also has to, it's our hobby that we make a living of, you know. And from the beginning, it was the community, it was gathering together and fun that made us play the handball. Yeah, so always remember that. Yeah.
Talking about success and Danish handball, the Danish handball women's national team won 3 consecutive Olympic Games. What do you think made this team special?
I think again the joy of playing handball and also the allowance to have this joy. I think that has been very important for Danish handball. Also, I think at that period we make these players who could win a game. You know, this. Yeah, number one players that were very good in lot of in every way in a handball team, and that's, and also very different players who could take over for each other every time. And I think also maybe the hierarchy, you know what I mean, in the team, that you have some leaders and some other people, and everyone accepted the role. I think also that was very important for this period.
Was it a strong hierarchy in the team?
Yeah, it was a strong hierarchy sometimes, yes. But I also think we had a lot of fun and tried to make, when new players joined the team, try to make them feel comfortable. But it was a strong hierarchy also, yes.
Yeah. And I just mentioned the Danish women's national handball team won at the 1996 Olympics, the 2000 Olympics, and 2004. What happened after 2004?
Maybe I think it's something about all the from the young players in Denmark. I don't think we are good enough to use the time on this technical part of handball. I think it's only about winning sometimes, and only about a system, make a system in handball, and so you don't get the players to think individually. I don't like to say robots, but it's a little bit about the trainer standing on the side and shouting what the players should do. So it's not independent handball, and that's a little shame. So I think we have to go back, back in time, and make this exceptional handball players again, who can, win a match and change a match, because that's that means a lot for a team. Yeah.
Okay. Do you have a morning routine?
I always start to make some coffee. That's my morning. And I think over the time I've been, I like to train in the morning, run or make some weight training, you know. I've been good to, I train myself to train in the morning, you know. I did a lot of that back in the days. Now I try to come back to this stage because I need to get a little more in shape. But but otherwise it was wake up and make some coffee, eat, and then what you normally do.
How do you prepare yourself for important moments?
Sometimes I try, when I played, you think about that also, or just in general?
Both.
Both. I've never been good to start, you know, 1 week before with the preparation, everything. It's always been the few days up to this important thing that I've started to get my focus. So I think that's something that has followed me over in everything I do. But when I start to focus, then I focus. Then I'm very good to stay focused and prepare myself in sometimes short time also. Yeah. But of course, when you know you have these important matches, then there's a lot of things in the weeks before this match. Of course, there is. But my focus, I think I'm not so good if I have too long time to preparation. It's better for me to have a few days. Yeah.
And in that Olympic final in 2004, the final went into overtime. You guys, the Danish team, was close to losing. And then I think you scored the three last goals. I mean, always to come back, right? How did you stay strong mentally to bring out the best performance in these crunch times?
I think that also has to do with the whole tournament. I think I got this confidence in myself, and I knew that I could take the chances because I felt this what you call it, flow. You know what I mean when I say flow. I wasn't afraid to make the mistakes. Because if you are afraid to make the mistakes, then you make the mistakes. Yeah. I didn't think about the mistakes at this time. I just did things without thinking, actually, I think. That's when I think back. That I think that was one of the reasons why I did that. Yeah.
Yeah. And did you get that flow feeling ever again before or after? To the same extent as in that Olympic final? Or at the Olympics?
Yeah, I've had some moments also in my the national clubs also where I have experienced this feeling inside. And I could feel it before the match. Also, I could feel the hours before when I was out in the garden or what I was did at home. I could feel that, okay, today I can feel I have this feeling again. That was actually a little bit funny sometimes because it when I had the feeling it was also the right after the game. I could say yeah, you played okay this today, but you also had this feeling. Yeah, so I have these moments again. Yes, sometimes.
And do you have what do you think contributes to getting this feeling? Can you deliberately get into that state?
Yeah, I think it's a maybe it's a combination about the whole I don't know life, how you settled, how you learn from all the ups and downs. I got very much stronger over the years mentally. Yes, I think that's also a part of it, and accepting the role of being high in the hierarchy. You know, with everything that's everything you have to deal with on the court or outside the court also with everything. So I also think that has something to do about it.
Yeah. And you just mentioned you learned to stay mentally strong. How do you overcome setbacks?
I try to do something try to do something else than thinking about handball, you know. Try to get away just for so hours or something else. I talk with people I know who gives me energy and not people who don't give me energy, if you know what I mean. You have to get back to the pluses and not just only the minus, you know. Talk to the ones I knew got me energy. I think that's important to me. Also, maybe just use, 30 minutes in the hall alone with myself and getting these shirts in the corners and just exercise some movements. That was also something that gave me confident and back to trust myself again. Yeah.
Yeah. Now we get to the question, who's your role model and why?
I don't think I actually have a role model. But if I go back to thinking handball, then when I was quite young, I always thought that Austra Frederikas, I don't know if you, Austrian handball player, I think she was I liked her style, I liked her way of fighting in matches, and she was, she could do a lot of things, and I admired her very much. So that was one I looked a little bit up to, but I don't have role models actually like that, no.
What is the best advice you received and who gave it to you?
I think actually that was the part of don't think 100%, then think 90%, because no human being can be 100% all the time. And that was one mental coach who gave that advice to me sometimes, and I've used that a lot. Yeah.
Back in the days, how did a typical training day look like?
It was, it could be, I woke up, go to training, go home, eat, and then, do what you do, go for walk, cleaning, and then go for handball one more time, and then home to make dinner or stay with one, two teammates. We have also this eating clubs and everything, where we join each other for food. And yeah, I think that's pretty much what a normal training day looked like. Two passes per day, and then just relax or go experience something and be together with the teammates. Yeah.
What is going on in the life of Katrine Fruelund at the moment?
At the moment, I have just at this moment, I have too much in my life. I think I just started a new work. I've been, I sit in a department where we control how the support from EU. The Europe Parliament give to the farmers, they get some support. And I'm in this department where we control that they stay by the rules to get the support. Yeah. And I'm a team leader in this department. Yeah. And then I sit in the city council also here in Anders. Decide how this city should develop in every way. So I've been there for 8 years now, and then I sit in. I have this boarding. I sit. It's a boardings and everything. So I have, and then I just accepted to be a part of the youth national team in Denmark. Women's youth national team to be the assistant trainer, what you call the second trainer. So that's a lot of, and then of course I have three kids, 8, 6, and 3 years old. So of course they have all my time also. So yeah, but right now there's a lot of things to look after in my life. Yeah, also maybe too much. Yeah, yeah. I'm happy to be back in the handball world again. So maybe I can teach some of the things I've experienced to some of the youth players. I think that's very, very, I like that that thing. Yeah.
You can give something back.
Yeah, I hope.
Do you want to nominate someone to be interviewed?
Oh, I've thought about that, and it's maybe Mette Jakobsen, a swimmer from Denmark. And she was a very good swimmer, and she was always also with the 2000 Olympics.
Really cool, really cool. Mm-hmm. Where can people find you?
In my garden, I think. In this, I live on a little farm in Denmark, and I love this place. That's my heart here. Yeah.
Any online social media profiles?
I have. Of course, I have a Facebook and a LinkedIn profile. Instagram. I am not very good at this social media thing. I'm not so good at that. So If the people write me a note, sometimes I can go a few days before I see it and everything. Yeah, but I have this profiles.
Really cool. Katrine, thanks a lot for your time. That was awesome.
You're welcome. Yeah, it was very, very fine.